more day. Yeah, well, come with me. The Bible, John 12, many quotes and says, Matthew 21, verse 19 and 12. I was able to get those verses in your bulletin, so I'm not going to be thinking about this. I can line things here. John 12. I love this time of year. Pay attention and then probably say, well, wait a minute, you told us back in the fall, you love that time. Well, I love that. And one of the reasons I love the fall is because it's such a reminder of the death. He told us that a blessing to die falls to the ground and cannot be destroyed. So it's a reminder to see the leaves turn and fall off the tree. What Jesus did to the cross, and we get to this time. And all these things that fell in the ground began to swell and bring about this time of year is also the reminder that we need to stay with him. It's the reminder that we're raised from the dead, that we're wise and that we get to do the same thing. We die to ourselves, we die to Christ, and we get to walk this way. So it's a 2,000 years of beautiful Christ, the symbol of the Lord. But he had a concern about this church. Here's what he read. We'll read it, and I'll kind of talk about it just a little bit. He said this, but I'm afraid that as the serpent deceived me by his craftiness, that your mind, even the church, he's saying, your mind will be led astray from the simplicity and the purity of devotion to Christ. For if one comes and preaches another Jesus, that's what I'm trying to make today, another Jesus. If someone comes preaching another Jesus, which we have not preached, or you receive a different spirit, which you have not received, or a different gospel, which you have not accepted, you bear this beautiful. That's a little hard to understand, a little hard to interpret that last part. It sounds like a good thing, but it's not here. It's, other translations say, you put up with that splendidly, or you put up with that easily enough. In other words, if someone comes preaching another Jesus, instead of fighting that or standing up to say, no, this is wrong, and Paul says, some of you just absorb it. You just take it in your good times. And so he was concerned, even in his day, that there were those who were preaching another Jesus, and even those in the church were being pulled into that, and they were actually bearing it beautifully. They were just kind of eating it up. And so in their day, in our day, we run into the same thing. There are so many different ideas about Jesus. See, here's what we normally think as a church. Okay, we kind of are, we just say it real bluntly, we're the Jesus crowd, okay? We're the ones that believe in Jesus. We're the ones that put our faith in Jesus. We're the ones that honor Jesus. And then there's the rest of them who just don't. They just don't. They don't have anything to do with Jesus. But you kind of look at it so black and white sometimes. I want you to know something. The devil is so much flyer than that. He's more fly than that. And he comes at us with all these different distractions and ways that can make you. So what he does is he mixes right in the middle of all that a Jesus crowd, but one that is distorted. Not the real Jesus, not the true Jesus. It's all these different ideas about Jesus. You've heard the same many times. People talk about truth. They'll say, well, that's your truth. You got your truth. I got my truth. You know, a lot of people got their own truth. But we know that that's not true. There's only one truth. They do the same thing with Jesus. good. You got your Jesus, you believe what you want. I got my Jesus, I think my Jesus is going to be there, and so forth and so on. But so there's a lot of Jesus that's grown up from truth. And so we run into that in our day as well. And we're not, in this little new series we're doing leading up to Easter, and our title is The Most Eternally Significant Week in History. It's eternally significant because of the real Jesus. What happened that last week that he was on the earth before his death and resurrection? Last week we began to look at the triumphal entry. Well, we didn't really get into it much, but we talked about the donkeys. That he was going to bring those donkeys to him, and he was going to ride on one of those donkeys. And so today we're going to get a little bit deeper. We're going to move a little more down the road, literally. Down the road, the triumphal entry. And we need to know that this was at the Passover. It all happened at the Passover. Scholars believe there were 21 to 2 million people present in Jerusalem in that week. That's way above normal. So people came from all over the land. We also know that this is the only time. Because it's recorded in the Gospels that Jesus, in doing his ministry, that he actually planned an event that would draw attention to himself. He usually didn't do that. Remember what he always did? He would heal somebody or do a miracle, and he'd say, "I'm telling you, you know, don't think about this. Just straight away and do what you need to do. But don't tell anybody." But not now. We're at the last week of his life on earth before his death and resurrection. And for the first time, he actually plans this whole thing. And he promotes a public demonstration. There's some reasons for that. One of them is to fulfill prophecy. Different prophecies got fulfilled during this week. So one of them was to fulfill prophecy. But the other one was to force the religious leaders to act. You know anything about the Gospels leading up to this time all this time of Jesus' ministry? They were always wanting to kill him. Always wanting to kill him. They wanted to get him, just take him out. And he always escaped or made things in such a way where they couldn't get that done. Well, now we get to the last week of his life. So we read in some of the Gospels where they were afraid that all these people, if they killed him now, there would be a riot or be trouble. So they were like, let's put it off. Let's put it off until after the Passover. And so it's crucial that it happened this week on the Passover because so many prophecies can be fulfilled. And so Jesus is pretty much pushing their buttons. He's pushing their buttons so that they will say, all right, we're going to do it now. Because he wanted it to be done. Because this is when it happened. Matter of fact, you know, a lot of the Old Testament prophets told us what's going to happen, especially Daniel, who told us about this very day that Jesus would rise from the dead. You have to do a lot of research to figure out. You can figure out that really, it said it would happen on this day. And so it had to happen on the day. So Jesus is pushing buttons, making them happen, and they did it. And so it's in his timing. So with all that said, by the way, let's jump into what John read, verse 12, 15. And so on the next day, the large crowd who had come to the feast, when they had heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem, they took the branches of the palm trees and went out to meet him and began to shout, "Hosanna, blessed be he who comes in the name of the Lord, even the King of Israel." So they laid out crowds and heard he was coming just outside the city. He was coming in, and they all started gathering around. So this large crowd, and they're singing Hosanna, and they're throwing their coats on the ground and palm branches on the ground. And they all seem like they're all the same thing. They're all pointed in the same direction. But here's what we know. They weren't all the same. They were not unlike those in our day who claimed to follow Jesus, offered to appear to be following Christ for all the same reasons, when actually there are a variety of reasons. that people are interested in constructing with one another. And that day, there were actually several groups in that large crowd. I didn't have room in your basement. I'm making my life look as fast as you take notes. This is the same kind of illustrated by different kinds of people that were in this crowd when we were at this day. The first one was what I would call the revolution crowd. We read about them in Mark 11:10. Blessed is the coming of the kingdom of our Father David. Hosanna in the highest. It's right in the middle of their Hosanna. What they're doing is they're saying, blessed is coming this kingdom. It's a kingdom they were looking for. Again, in John here in verse 13, it says they were crying out, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, even the king. And so what this crowd was looking for, this revolution crowd, they were looking for a king and a kingdom. They wanted a new king, and they wanted a new kingdom to arise. This group was tired of being ruled by Rome. And they remembered the history that in the Old Testament. They knew all about David, who was the greatest king of Israel before Jesus, of course. They remembered all of his exploits and all the things that happened, and they had romanticized the victories of King David. And they longed for another king like David, who was going to come and set up another kingdom like David, and it would be one of military might like David. It would lead them, this genius new king would lead them in overthrowing the desperately Romans. That means they were looking for a physical king. That was the revolution crowd. Then there was the second crowd, what I would call the revelation crowd. This crowd was looking for something new. They were looking for something fresh. Verse 7 here tells us, so the people who were with him when he called Lazarus out of the tomb and raised him from the dead, they continued to testify about him. So they were hearing about what he'd done about 6 days earlier with Lazarus, and they were continuing to testify. The word just kept going out. This made them become excited. They were excited that something's going on here, something different about this guy. Perhaps this is a group that had been just kind of bored, disinterested with the heavy-handed demands of the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the Herodians and all these religious leaders and all their rituals, but no power. And they were just bored with that. They wanted something different. And this Jesus came offering something fresh, something real that they could kind of wrap their devotion on. And they were intrigued. The revelation crowd. There's a third crowd. It's the curiosity crowd. We read about them in Matthew 21:10. And when he entered Jerusalem, all the city was stirred, saying, who is this? In other words, they started to see this one person riding in on this little donkey. Everyone is stirred. The whole city is rushing to that place, and they're all asking, who in the world could this be? What is it about this person that's making everyone do this? These folks were already in town for a celebration. I mean, they were there to celebrate the Passover. But all of a sudden, all eyes seemed to be on Jesus. And they were curious. I mean, you know, curiosity is a strong pull. I'm trying to say it all the time. Curiosity is a strong pull. I don't know what that meant for a long, long time. But it's trying to tell me to kind of do that back. Because I was always a question asker. And, you know, I was curious about everything. And curiosity has a strong pull. And so obviously this group wanted to know why. Everyone seemed to be centered around Jesus. And they wanted to go find his way. The next is another group, the miracle chasers. So look at verse 18. And for this reason also the people went and met him, because they heard that he had performed this sign. This sign speaking of raising Lazarus from the dead about 6 days prior. So they heard about this miracle. They've never seen anybody raised from the dead before, most of them. So they heard about that, and they kind of wanted to get in on that, and they were there for the miracle. Here's what we read in Luke 19:37. As soon as he was approaching, Jesus was all the miracles which they had seen. It was the miracles that were drawing them. And they tuned in primarily for miracles, probably hoping to see one, to witness a miracle. Finally, there was fifth crowd, the celebration crowd, in verse 19. So the Pharisees said to one another, "You see that you are not doing any good. Look, the world has gone after you." And so they're saying that everybody's gone after me. God just wanted to reason apart. There's a celebration crowd. Just about any reason we're doing it, if a whole crowd is going after him in one direction, then this bunch is not going to be left out. They're going to follow the crowd. They're going to go to the party. And so they don't want to be left out. And they thrived on excitement. And so they followed so they could get in on the party, get in on the celebration. Now, the bottom line, all these groups were looking for their own version of Jesus. So it's come on the same. But the larger point, doing so, looking for their own personal version of Jesus, they were actually rejecting the real Jesus, the one who came as the Savior. They missed that Jesus. That was the Jesus that they needed most, but that was the Jesus that would be totally rejected within days, because they were looking for, they were longing for another Jesus. Another Jesus who would come on their own terms. And it's the same today. Many claim to know Jesus or follow Jesus, but often it's another Jesus. Now, let me see if I can illustrate it this way. How many of you need your Subway? I follow it. Let me tell you about Subway. Let me educate you on Subway. I like Subway. I like the ones eating the Subway sandwich. Here's what you do. It's a process. But it's pretty good. The process is great. I love it. You walk in, the first thing you do is get to see the kind of bread you want. It's about four or five choices. You choose this certain kind of bread, and then you get to tell them whether I want a 6-inch one or a 12-inch one. It's a third thing. So you get to make some decisions. And then the next step on down a little bit further, you've got three meats to choose from. You get to choose what kind of meat you want. Or if you want meat at all. And then the cheese is done. And you get to choose the onion. Maybe I choose the chicken teriyaki. I don't even know what any of those other sandwiches taste like. I choose the chicken teriyaki. Then they want to know, what kind of cheese do you like? And I say, well, I'm a good patriot. I want the American cheese. Even though there are other options. You don't need to be able to say no cheese at all. Then they want to know. I'm like, well, I like my sandwich. Yeah, let's do that. Let's toast it, but you don't have to. You can do it untoasted if you want to. Then you get down to the veggies, all kinds of veggies. You pick some of them, don't pick some of them. You get to choose. You get to do it just like you want. And finally, you get to the sausage. Your sausage, they only get you one sausage. And you may like me. I like the sweet onion stuff. I like giving me a double dose of that stuff. And so you can ask for twice as much for the charge. And by the time you're done with that whole thing, you know what you've done? You built a sandwich for the most of it that you want. Here's what's really neat. You get that sandwich and you don't especially like what you chose today. The next time you just adjust the point. You can change it a little bit. You can change it up and order it in a different way. In other words, you get to make it up as you go along. Whatever you're feeling like today, you can adjust that sandwich to today. Your particular preference for the particular day. You know, a lot of people treat Jesus like a Subway Jesus. You know, they just kind of make it up as they go along. They claim to follow him. Whatever particularly fits me today. You know, on a particular day, I'll pick the Christmas. They're following another Jesus. Not the Jesus they've been offered. In other words, not the one that Jesus came offering, but the one of their own choosing, the one of their own make it. I was actually tempted a little bit to title this message, Designing Jesus. Because that's what a lot of people want to do. They want to design their own Jesus. You know, I'm perfectly happy with Jesus most of the ways, but I've got this thing going on in my life, and I want to be able to say, I'm going to look at that. Well, I'm going to agree with the culture, and that's the whole lot of this thing. You know, that kind of thing. It's a different Jesus. And so they want to design their own Jesus. They don't want a Jesus who says to them, you just need to become more like Jesus. They want Jesus who they can design to become more like Jesus. That's another Jesus. Look at our first verse there. Paul talked about it. He kind of goes to that kind of Jesus. He just draws that in so easy because God is an easy kind of thing to accept. That's what Paul is working on. Now, as different as these five groups were, they had at least two things in common, basically. One of them would remain satisfied with the Jesus that they offered. This thing came to point pretty quickly. And the second thing they had in common was that these days, likely most of them, would unite again. But this time they would unite again because of the crucifixion of Jesus. They released the way to the people, the way of the people, the way of the people. So what were their problems with Jesus? How could they be all in with Jesus on one day, just 4 days later, they're totally united with Jesus, for the most part, not all of them, I'm sure, but for the most part. What was the problem? Well, for that revolution crowd, Jesus came riding in on the wrong animal. He came riding in on the wrong animal. Verse 15 says, "Fear not, daughters, I am behold, your king is come and seated on a donkey's colt." In other words, this was the most humble way for him to come riding in. This revolution crowd, they weren't looking for a humble leader. They were looking for a military leader with fight in. And so the revolutionary animal was a horse. If we fast forward to history a little bit, well, it's history a lot at this time. Look on the front of your bulletin. Here's what we read about the second coming of Jesus. In Revelation 19:11, I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse, and he who sat on it is called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he judges and wages war. Now, I want you to look at the verse and look at the picture up here. These don't go together, do they? But this revelation crowd, they were looking for the verse. They were looking for the Jesus that would come on a white horse, waging war. What they got that day was this humble Jesus on a white horse. That's not the Jesus they wanted. See, he was riding on a beast of war. They wanted war. The only war that would take place that week would be the battle that would take place in the garden. We'll talk about that in another time. But also that battle that would take place on the cross when the burden of bearing would be Jesus Christ taking on the burden of taking the sins of the world onto himself and paying the greatest price that's ever been paid to redeem the lost sinners, including this bunch that was there that day. You see, the revolution crowd obviously did not like this. All right, then there was that revolution crowd. Why didn't they like it? Why did they turn on Jesus? Well, within days, they were going to be left with that same old empty religion that they'd been accustomed to. They thought something fresh was coming. They got excited about that. They thought it would be an exciting new thing with miracles attached to it. But they were left with what they began with. Just, and they refused to accept that Jesus failed. And so they too went. How about the theologians? Why did they turn on Jesus? Well, nothing can hold their attention for very long. Because it's a lot like today's short attention span. You can't stay with something for very long. They needed to move on. They needed to move to the next thing, you know, where the grass appeared to be greener, where something, you know, better was going on. They too were simply looking for another. And then there was the miracle station. Why didn't they stay with Jesus? Well, they didn't see a miracle. They would have if they had stuck with him, but they didn't. See, the only miracle that would happen that week would be the one on the cross, where the man, God, would take all the sins of the whole world onto himself and take the wrath of God against all those sins onto himself. The wrath that the sinners deserve. Well, as is always the case with this question, when the party's over, they're just still looking for another party. And the party was over pretty quickly. So they went somewhere else because they didn't find the Jesus that they wanted there. They too wanted another Jesus. So, even though all these groups saw what was happening here, they helped as well, I'm not sure. They put the coats on the ground and the palm branches, like rolling out that red carpet. And they appeared at least to be on the same page. But in reality, they never were on the same page. They never were on the same page with God. Even the celebration, that they shouted, it shows just how out of tune they really were. You see, prophetic scripture is used in this passage to express some omission. Here's the prophecy about that day. It's in Zechariah 9:9. I want you to notice the red underlined words. This is what Zechariah originally said. Rejoice greatly, O God of Zion. Shout in triumph, O God. Behold, your king is coming to you. He is just and endowed with salvation, humble and founded on a donkey. He's a born and colt, the foal of a donkey. Right? That was the prophecy. Now, flip your bulletin over, and we'll see how Matthew spelled it out for us in his version of the story. He says this: say to the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you. He's been found on a donkey, he's on the colt, the foal, and the beast of burden. Matthew knows what's missing from the original prophecy. When they begin to shout this, they left out some things. They left out, rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion, shout in triumph. That your king is coming, he's just, he's endowed with salvation. They left all of that out. Why did they do that? Why triumph and just and salvation all missing? Why did they miss it? Because there's something here to celebrate. They're celebrating, but there's nothing here to celebrate. There is no triumph. There is no justice. There is no salvation. Jesus came offering salvation by grace and mercy, but they rejected death, but they rejected him in the process. At the beginning of Jesus' ministry, we looked at that in the very beginning of our study of John, John 1:11. So he came into his own, and his own received him not. So now we get to the end of his ministry, and the same thing is happening. He's coming to his own, and his own are not receiving him. And the result would be that justice and salvation would have to be postponed until his second coming. And that time there will be justice for all the rejected of Christ. And there will be salvation for all the sinners of Christ. No celebration that day. Not really. Look what we read here. Luke 19. 39. Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to the teacher, rebuke your disciples for doing this for the last time, for the road. This is the Jesus thing, should I tell you? This is the time of silence. See this? Well, Jesus saying the created stones, the stones that I created myself, they understand this moment better than the people. The people of God's perception. That is amazing. In other words, the glory of his creation, man didn't get it. But the stones would. You ever notice how mankind, think about this for a moment, you ever notice how mankind is the only part of God's creation that's disappeared? That's out of step with God. Out of tune with God. I mean, you got buttercups growing up in the field. Come every single year. Every single year. When it's their time, they come up. They're in tune with God. They don't change. Some comes up, some goes down. Everything else in creation is still obedient to God. Everything but man, the very crown of creation. We're the ones that rebel against God. Creation. You see, one of the greatest events in history was completely composed by those who were what was that event? It was the prophets who told about this moment. 400 years, God had been totally silent, but the people knew those prophecies still stood, and they were waiting, and they were looking. As I said earlier, Daniel even nailed down the exact time, and they still missed it. The visitation of the Messiah, everybody else is celebrating for all the wrong reasons. Jesus is not celebrating at all. He is the opposite of celebration. Look at the rest of the week. Luke 19:41-44, when he approached Jerusalem and saw the city, he wept over it, saying, if you had known that this day, even you, the things which make for peace, that now that have been taken from your eyes, for the days will come upon you when your enemies will throw a barricade against you, surround you, and hem you in on every side. They will level you to the ground, and your children will be you, and they will not leave you one stone upon another. That happened 40 years later, 70 AD, when the Roman general Titus came to Jerusalem. It was not an event, but his wife was a good they didn't recognize him. You know, it wasn't because they weren't looking for Jesus. They were looking for him. They were longing for him. The problem was, they were looking for and longing for badly Jesus. Not the one that God had promised. One that was based on their own desire. How is it possible that so many people, even those that God had on. How could God have made the real Jesus on that incredible day? Well, let me show you one. Was this the puzzle for me sometimes? until we start putting all our scripts together. Just give me a photo up here. I don't know if y'all can see this photo. Stop by my office and get up real close to it. See that cross? There's a cross going from over here to over to the celestial city, to the heavenly city. And on that cross, on this side of that cross, there are gazillions of people going down to that hellish prison. This is a picture of this passage of Scripture. Hosanna is Jesus here. But not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. In other words, those who believe in the Jesus that God the Father has promised is coming. That Jesus who would follow that Jesus in the way that God wants us to follow that Jesus. Many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, do we not prophesy in your name and cast out demons? Jesus is a good teacher. Jesus is a great leader. And you're all looking back in history. You're looking back at a prophet and back at a leader and back at a teacher. And some of the believe today that Jesus is a permission of God. That the God of the Old Testament all of a sudden, goes with the flow. He's very permissive, God, who would actually compromise Scripture if it gets in the way of our preferred lifestyle. I'm going to tell you something. That's what a lot of people are looking for, that kind of Jesus, but that's not the Jesus. It's not the Jesus that the Bible presents. But so many accept another Jesus, as Paul said, he's only a man. Even beautiful. Listen, if the number of Americans who claim to follow Jesus were truly following the real Jesus, the biblical Jesus, we have a dramatically different America right now. Unborn babies as they possibly can. Many who claim to follow Jesus will support that, even though Jeremiah 1:5 says, before I was formed, before you formed me in the womb, before that you knew me already, before you even formed me in the womb, you already knew me. In other words, I was important to you. Psalm 139. You formed me in my mother's womb. I was fearfully and wonderfully made. Who made us? God made us. Those little babies are that unformed substance. And in your book were written the days that were ordained for me before it even started. Lazy, that's the following of Jesus. They promised supporting Lazy. He promised to promote the ungodly practices, things that's written. So the scripture says, Genesis 2, God put man in a very deep sleep. He took a rib from him and he created a woman out of it. And he brought that woman to the man and he joined her together with him as one flesh to be his wife forever. One man. Jesus, but not Jesus, the Bible. This is not a Jesus. We more adhere to a Savior Jesus. You think, well, that's a wonderful thing. That's a good thing. It is a good thing. But the problem is they're adhering to a Savior Jesus, but not a Lord Jesus. And you can't separate the two. You see, the Lord Jesus will never compromise the words of Scripture. Say without any doubt whatsoever that the Lord Jesus, no matter what you hear on the news, the Lord Jesus is not his favorite sunset. The Lord Jesus is not his favorite killing babies in the womb, and he's not his favorite of a whole lot of other things because the Word of God says that. And he will never compromise the Scripture. You see, the real Lord Jesus makes the man of God. Do we put our own preferences aside? Find out what he prefers doing with him. And follow him. He didn't know what to take back to him. That's what lordship is. The sense of man takes after another Jesus. Even though just like these five groups who were present when the real Jesus rode into town, the Jesus that they were being offered was not the Jesus they desired. Because they wouldn't come back to Jesus. So you get a question from what you call it. Who's Jesus coming from? For all those who are listening, which Jesus do you follow? The one who is visited us with an offer of salvation according to the Scripture? Or another Jesus who lines up with your preferences and your lifestyle choices and your particular whims from one day to another? The subway Jesus. You see, if you're seeking Jesus at all, you're very close. If you're thinking, you know, you're close, but I want you to understand something this morning. There's only one real Jesus, and if you miss this Jesus, you've missed out. But there's good news. In this very moment, you should decide to follow the real Jesus by surrendering yourself to his lordship, by confessing your sins, that we all have them, by repenting of those sins, in other words, turning from those sins to the Lord, and by asking forgiveness for those sins, and being cleansed of those sins, by the precious blood of the real Jesus that was shed on Calvary's cross. I challenge you today to give him your life, and you'll be prepared incredible sacrificial love of the Savior, and an immeasurably deep love of the Father. How deep is that love? I'm going to ask you the same thing to the Lord this morning. How deep, Father, Thank you.